Hello, everybody, and welcome to Tort Snuffers. I'm your host, Colin Connors. With me, as always, is my wonderful co-host, Alicia Garza.
Hello, everyone.
Also joining us today, that girl from Canada, Elise Anderson.
Hello.
The always amazing Prince Ty.
Good evening.
Amazing Survivor fan and amazing Survivor player, Billy Garcia.
Hey, everybody.
And our special guest from Survivor Philippines, the wonderful Artis Silvester. Hey, Artis.
What's up, people?
All right, so before we begin, I want to do some house cleaning. First, I want to say fantastic episode. But all you viewers out there, there are actually still spots left in our winner pick fan contest. How do you enter? It's simple. Just post the name of someone who hasn't been picked yet, and if that person wins, you win our fantastic prize. And in honor of Survivor Game Changers, our prizes this time are stuff you change, like an old pair of underwear. You can get some of that. You can get $10 off some tires and maybe some pizza. So real quick, the players that are available for you fans to pick are Aubrey, Siri, Ozzy, Haley, Troyzan, Zeke, JT, Ty, Jeff, and Debbie. We got a full list of people. So go ahead, get those entries in so you can win that underwear. So we have a whole bunch to talk about. I'm sorry we were a little bit late. Billy was explaining to Alicia about tax questions, and Alicia made the astute observation that if you win Survivor, maybe you'll want to go to New York and have to file their taxes there. So we know someone's not winning Survivor tonight, and that, of course, is Caleb. So, Artis, I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to jump to you. And normally we like to do things sequentially, but you posted this kind of rant on Facebook right when it ended that caught my eye, where you said it was a bad move and all that other good stuff. So, Artis, let's break it down. What do you think made that move so bad? Was it just bad for Ty? Was it just bad for Brad? What was your interpretation of what went down?
It wasn't bad for Brad. Brad wanted Caleb gone. Okay. It was a bad move for the tribe. All it did was ensure that their ass is going to be back at tribal council next week.
Exactly. That's kind of how I thought, too.
Artis, would you say that this tribe could be the new Matt Singh from this?
No. What I would say, though, is if had Jeff not shaken it up and split it into three tribes, Malcolm's tribe was definitely going to be the new Matt Singh because they were going to get swept. That was just going to be a brutal, brutal slaying.
It was exciting to see the tribe split up. But Artis, as someone who's been on a three tribe scenario, can you explain just how hard it is to blend in on a smaller tribe? And I'm going to talk to Billy about this too, because he's about the same thing. And I mean, you never got to play on a bigger tribe. So what do you think that's like going from the, there's 10 of us I can hide to, oh my God, there's only six of us. What can I do?
Well, the biggest twist here is just like, it's not like they're all individuals newly getting together. They split this up and they came with majorities. You know, there were alliances already set when this split came up. And if you were on the back side of it, you got your work cut out trying to win this game. Just like with Caleb and in his situation, normal circumstances, had they been just brand new, had just met everybody, there's no way Caleb was going home, because they would have been like, we need to keep our tribe strong so we can win challenges. Brad is thinking at the merge already.
Yeah.
Ty, and he played Ty. He knew Ty wanted to keep Caleb. And he just told Ty that BS. Well, you got to think what's good for your game. And if Ty would have been thinking, Caleb was good for his freaking game.
Yeah, exactly.
Caleb was horrible. Caleb was horrible for Brad's game.
So Billy, I want to jump to you. How did it feel on Cook Islands when you realized just how small that tribe was, of being like, wow, I better not piss anyone off to throw a challenge, or like there's nowhere to hide?
Actually, when you're in a small tribe, things that are not strategic tend to play up even more. Things like gender and geography, and in this case, previous tribe, and that plays up a lot, because you need a criteria for getting rid of somebody, and when you're in a small tribe, there's very little criteria, so you go for the big obvious one. And in this case, for my case, it was geography. Everybody was from California, and I was from New York, so it was that obvious. But for this tribe, this episode, it was previous tribe. So that's what sucks about small tribes. And I have to agree a lot here with what's been said so far by artists that Ty definitely play the game for Culpepper and not for himself. He basically handed the tribe over to Culpepper.
But real quick, you said you were from California and they went from New York. You moved to New York.
No, the other way around.
Okay. I was going to say, did you move to New York so you'd be okay next time?
Yeah, they're all from California and I'm from New York, so yeah.
Those Californians. Exactly. Elise, go ahead. I believe you want to comment on this. And I was going to jump to Ty real quick.
Yeah, I think what Artis said was that Ty wasn't thinking enough. I feel like Ty was thinking too much. He was up in, more than Culpepper, he was up in his head being like, oh my God, I need to think about after the merge, they're going to stay weird together. And it's like the Sierra mom thing in Blood versus Water, but it's not even happened yet. They're not even close to the merge. They're only like 2 days or... was it 6 days into this game? And I feel like that might be a problem for Ty, having been on such a recent season, that he's still in day 39 mode, when really you should be in day 2 mode.
Well, and I'm going to jump to... go ahead, Billy.
I was just going to add to Elise and say, he wasn't just thinking too much, he was talking too much. He kept saying over and over again, yeah, me and Caleb are buddies, we're friends. And
I'm like,
what are you doing? What are you doing?
Well, and the premiere episode, Ty was showed to not really know how to talk to Sheree, and this episode he doesn't know how to talk to Brad, so Ty is just going to be a caveat for failure, unlike the Ty that's on our panel, who's a caveat for success. Ty, I want to come at you with this big picture idea, and I'm going to talk to everyone else about this. Millennials versus Gen X, last season, there was the big swap. However, every single time after the swaps went, it was someone from the majority alliance that went. The people were willing to, you know, backstab people that they played with on their previous tribes. You had it when Figgy got voted out. You had it when CC was voted out. Why is it that those new players weren't taking risks, but yet we have all these game changers, people called game changers, and they're not taking the risk. They're not playing like All-Stars. They're basically saying, we have our work cut out, which reminds us, and I'm taking this back to Survivor All-Stars, where there was basically a Pagongan come the merge. What is it about All-Star seasons that actually lead to somewhat safe gameplay? I mean, we saw it in Heroes versus Villains, too.
Because they're smarter than they were before. To that end, they know the textbook move to make, at least most of them do. And to that end, let's put it this way. Brad Culper has improved his game from the last time. He now finds himself in a position of power, and he wanted to keep the power. And to that end, he did the move that was smart for him. And I feel like particularly in an All-Star season, if you go against the textbook move, people are going to wonder what's up. People are going to get paranoid about you on the other tribes. Like, if Culpepper's old tribe saw that they had kept, like Ty had suggested voting out Debbie. If Debbie was gone instead of either of those two, everybody probably would have freaked the hell out, because they would have been like, yeah, it would have created chaos, which goes into Billy's point, I believe, from last week, that in returning player seasons, you don't want chaos. You do not want to be the cause of chaos. Settled with you, and it hurts your game.
So, and I mean, I guess anyone can jump on this. The idea that All-Stars automatically means more crazy gameplay may not be true. All-Stars may understand the game more. Maybe that's why they play safely. Elise, you want to comment on that?
Yeah, I wanted to say that All-Stars kind of play the game hard, but I don't know why they're forcing this drama with the three tribe split, because like Billy said, it forces them to be less strategic. I think there's a lot more drama in an All-Star season if it's a heroes versus villains thing where they have to start eating each other and changing alliances within their own tribe, because who knows if you're going to make it to the merge. Like, it's that you have to play hard, play fast. As opposed to just like, well, they're not in our previous tribe, so we'll just get rid of them. And arbitrary things.
Billy and Artis, I love it that you guys both were on three tribe seasons, but I want to know, Artis, let's take you back to Survivor Philippines. Let's go 4 episodes in. Angie just got the boot. All right? And then suddenly they say, all right, you're going on to this new tribe, new beach, nothing. Do you think that's – I hate to use the word fair, but – I really hate how they do that on a personal thing. I hate how they say no shelter, no nothing. And don't you think that puts one tribe at a severe disadvantage?
It does, but by the same token, if you were on the out, if you were lucky enough to be put on that tribe because and you were on the outs on your original one, hell, you're just starting all over again. And I personally, I wouldn't have a problem with it. I would not have a problem with having to start all over with regards to shelter and food and all of that other stuff. All right. Because it is what it is, you know, and that also gives you an opportunity to mesh with other people, you know, get gameplay going. Right now, like I said, for people just to be thinking about making it to the merge, no, you're just trying to make it to the next day right now. The merge is just that you may not even be in the numbers for that merge. You just want to put yourself in a position to be able to just outlast this thing. I don't want to say, I would never say fly under the radar, because in a season like this, I look at Sandra and I'm like, how are they letting her? She pretty much last week just said, you guys have played this game 2, 3, 4 times and you haven't won it. Basically, she said, and you ain't gonna win it.
That's true.
She is pretty much, and I don't understand how they are not just trying to get rid of her. You know, I don't understand that. I don't, from last week, I don't understand how in the hell you let Ozzy jump in the fucking water and go uncontested for the tool chest, uncontested. He's just swimming out there. No, you go out there, y'all fight. I try to drown his ass. He ain't nowhere by himself. When I saw this, I was like, no, really? Y'all just let Ozzy just take off.
Well, and I think that's something to keep in mind, the idea of how caricatures and archetypes kind of play in this. And Billy, I want to throw it back to you because I want to talk to you about the tribe setup, but also about this idea of, you know, Sandra surviving the tribal councils and being the queen and doing all this alliance stuff.
No, she's a self-proclaimed queen. I'm like, no, this is a brand new day. I'm not gonna say what I'm gonna say, but no, I respect you and everything. You're a two-time winner, but your ass gotta go.
Well, no. And that's what I was saying. Like, maybe people are just so afraid, or they accept the archetype of Sandra's gonna, you know, be able to skate by. Aubrey's gonna do something strategic, and maybe, or Malcolm's gonna, or Ozzy's gonna be good in challenges. Malcolm's gonna, you know, be a little devious, and maybe those people believing in those archetypes might hold them back. It might cause people to move.
See, I personally believe in Lewis's subscription to her strategy in All Stars, which is all the winners go first, second, third, however many they are. Because then it's your season, you know. Then it's your shot to make it. They got their shot, you know. You want your own shot now, and for that to happen, if you're not a winner, is all the winners got to go first, second, third, fourth, like that. That's how Tina Wesson ended up first. It was thanks to Jenna Lewis and her philosophy, and I think that should be the philosophy for every returning player season. Having said that, I think what we got in the first two tribal councils, with people just watching Sandra and Tony go at it, was you got a lot of fandom going on, a lot of playing going on. You got a lot of fandom going on. It was like everybody
starstruck. Like,
yeah,
it's like if we had all bought a ticket to see Survivor Live.
Well, it did feel like a great kind of MMA fight, the Sandra Tony brawl, and that is going to go down in Survivor history. But Elise, while we're talking on this thing about winners, right now JT and Sandra are on the same tribe. JT, of course, is completely on the outs with the numbers, and Sandra, of course, seems to be kind of gunning for JT a bit. But not only is Sandra gunning for JT, something that I thought was super interesting as a Jeff Varner fan was Jeff Varner was given a lot of the narration of the Blue Tribe along with Malcolm. So from an edit standpoint, where do you think this leaves Jeff Varner, Malcolm, and I'm even going to say JT and Sandra? Is Sandra just going to be the winner killer? Is Jeff Varner going to win? I'm going to be right?
I honestly think Malcolm and Varner are in a pretty solid position right now. I think Varner sticking with Sandra is really good a thing, because we've seen him not being that good in the challenges. But when you're also on a tribe with someone who's not good at the challenges and has the huge threat of being the only two-time winner in Survivor, I think that's a great position for him to be on. Malcolm, I think, it, like I said before, I think this is his season, possibly, because now that he's a little older, a little bit wiser, and he's one of the top challenge people on this tribe, they can't really get rid of him, especially if they want to get rid of a JT. So I think he's in a pretty good spot as well. I am still worried for Sandra, because JT, while he didn't, while I love the move of him stranding them in the ocean from a TV strand standpoint, from an actual survivor gameplay standpoint, I feel like it's probably not a good idea, because he's such a charming guy that I think his biggest move should be just trying to be in good with his tribe.
Now, I want to go back to this being stranded out in the middle of the ocean thing. How in the hell are you stranded? You're not stranded. Just move your ass back to the line.
Well, I think JT was like, I'm going to give you all a ride on my back if you just hang back.
They just sat out there and watched them swim back. Oh, we can't go nowhere. We're stuck out here. We can't go nowhere.
It reminds me of, I used to have guinea pigs when I was a kid, and one of our guinea pigs would just sit there and couldn't move unless the other guinea pig came back to lead her away. I felt like that was the tribe. They were just like, well, we can't move until JT comes back.
Well, there are goats on that tribe, which, you know, I guess kind of similar to guinea pigs. Ty, and I wanted to actually throw the same question your way, because you're really good at edgic and stuff like that. One, I am trying to get a Cochrane from Caramone vibe from Malcolm. Maybe I'm just projecting. But two, what do you think Jeff Varner is looking at like right now? And also, Sandra, does she have legs?
I did not think that tonight was a good episode for Sandra. We'll start with that, because that was the point I wanted to originally make. Sure. Jeff Varner came out right away and said that JT was screwed. And whenever someone makes that bold of a proclamation that early, it doesn't necessarily reflect bad on Varner, but it reflects that JT may not be the first group on that tribe. They made a point of Sandra wanting to eat the baby goat, which makes her the villain in this situation. They even said there was a reason that she was on the villain tribe, because she wanted to eat the goat. And don't get me wrong, my fat ass would have wanted to eat the goat too. And I'd have been like, if we eat this goat now, we can eat the chickens later. That's just ruthlessness, and that's it. But they made a point of JT loving the goat, and Malcolm had the comments about Sandra being all about Sandra, which basically tells me that she could be going next episode. I felt it was a really bad episode for her, because let's face it, I think Varner's in a great position because he's sidled himself up next to Malcolm. Mm-hmm. Caleb actually mentioned tonight that the two people he was close with were Malcolm and Varner, so it looks like those two might have kind of been like working together on the old tribe. I see that they're in a good position, and I think they could afford to go with JT, who is a winner and therefore a bigger threat than either of them, or Sandra, who's a two-time winner and is a bigger threat than either of them. Either way, they're in a good spot on that tribe.
And Billy, I have a question. Would you eat the baby goat? And what did you make of the Ty's analysis just then?
If the chickens were not there, I would have eaten the baby goat. Before, I look at those chickens, and that's enough to get you to the food rewards. Mm-hmm. That's, in fact, that's more than enough to get you to the food rewards. So they really don't. Go ahead.
I didn't see a reason for chasing and catching the goats other than television.
Bored. Let's keep you on TV.
Right now, I can understand that you do get bored out there, and I probably would have ran out and chased them and everything. But there was no way they were going to eat those goats. You know, I just they had way too much food out there.
Artists, I think they chased them because Queen Sandra said that she wanted a goat, and that's why I think. And then they came to their senses afterwards. You know, they had a knee-jerk reaction.
It's like it's normal food, like it's. Like, Mexicans eat goat. It's called cabrito. Probably what Sandra was thinking about. Like, great, let's get some, like, large grill going. Like,
yeah, for me, it wasn't about whether or not goat tastes good. It was that they have more than enough chickens to make it to the
food. Okay, time real quick.
I'll say this.
But you could have, like, eggs and goat meat.
Eggs and goat meat. Okay.
I'll say this. Go ahead. I can picture exactly one other... All right. I can picture exactly one other survivor who would have gone and chased after the goat for no reason. But I don't want to trigger Artis, so I'm not going to mention who it is.
Yeah, that's true.
I like Artis too much. I don't want to do that. Right.
No, didn't they like try and catch a mountain goat last season? Like, didn't Fiddy and like all
the goat talk aside, Elise, Elise, real quick, would you eat the baby goat? And then what did you want to say?
You're muted, dude.
You're muted. All right, I like it better that way anyways. Okay. So what I want to kind of focus this next little bit about is those stuff we saw on the Green Tribe. Yeah, you're muted. So, Alicia, what did you make of... Oh, is Elise back? No, Elise isn't back, so I'm going to talk to you, Alicia.
No, I'm back. I just wanted to say that no, you don't eat the baby goat, because as soon as one person or more than one, you know the consensus is we don't want to eat the goat. You can't break the social, even if you're Queen Sandra and you think you're on top. It's not worth risking your position in the game over one freaking goat, especially when you have all those chickens there.
Like, well, what if everyone's like, oh, we don't want to eat the goat, but Sandra's like already putting the knife in it, and it's like, oh.
That's what I wanted to see.
I would do the Jen Brown thing while being like, nope, I can't be with this, and then walk away and then find an idol.
That'd be fantastic. So, Alicia, I didn't want to talk to you. I want you to start the conversation on the Green Tribe. So, we get a little bit of Troyzan and Andrea. And Troyzan, someone who you guys hear okay, but a lot of the panelists do not like, but I actually enjoy his stuff. Wait, was the Troyzan stuff before the goats? Okay. So, you saw the Troyzan teary-eyed, looking for the idol stuff. And also we saw that Andrea seemed to be kind of playing a bad game. What do you make of that? Do you think this was just like a one-off episode of Troyzan getting the idol and he was only getting the good edit because of that? Or maybe Troyzan actually has some legs in this game?
I think now that he has the idol, he has legs. Especially because... He was getting such a positive edit. I don't know why you would get such a positive edit only to flop like one episode later. You know, it was kind of like they were showing him to be the one that was discounted, but actually had, you know, some gameplay. Whereas Andrea, who's wildly regarded recently as being more of a strategic, like good all around player, was shown as kind of being able to be seen through. So.
And Billy, what did you make of that interaction? Because I think what we were supposed to get from that was Andrea's not doing too hot. Remember, from the premiere episode, we mentioned that Andrea doesn't seem to be getting the same kind of good edits she's been getting in her past two seasons.
She's, well, first of all, I think this whole story with Troyzan was getting is sort of the underdog story that you know, that you would expect with someone who just got an idol in this at the end of the episode. And the interaction between him and Andrea, in my opinion, is probably setting up Andrea for being the one who goes when the idol gets played.
Ooh, okay, I didn't think of that. And yeah, I want to ask you, Billy, and I'm going to throw this to artists too. You've been in challenges. How hard, or do you think it could have been easy, would it have been to actually get that little idol? And what would you have done?
Troyzan played it perfectly. That was the only way he was going to get that without being seen. That, to me, that was really the only way he could get that without being seen. Now, even if they had lost and were going to tribal, he could have been down there like he was so dejected that they lost. And that was the only way he could have played. Any other way, somebody would have said, something's up. What the hell's going on over there?
Well, and yeah, see, Billy.
I would say this, Colin, and I'm going to throw this to you because I'm curious in your opinion on this. It looks like, I could be wrong, but it looks like you have to find the clue for the idol to be planted.
Yes.
Away from showing what the other tables. Because if it were me, while everybody is leaving the challenge area, if the idols were there, I'd have just went over and took those two. And I'd have taken over three idols. So it looks like it's got to be.
And
an idol buffet.
I would say, I think you're
what
right.
What do you think?
I think you're right, because I was really watching that super intently. And people are going to screen grab it later. But I was staring at the same leg on every single table or the two other tables while it was going on. And I could have sworn the camera never tilted down enough to where we could see the exact crevice. But I'm almost positive they weren't there. So I think you're right that finding the clue triggers it. Which is funny because imagine someone finding a clue 2 minutes before going on challenges in production. Just like, oh, shit. Oh, we got to do it.
Wait over here. Bring you into just a minute.
So I gotta ask Billy though, what would have been your strategy like if you encounter something like that on your first challenge? Would you have just said?
No, like, I think he did it right. Where he had to wait until after first he put first of all he put himself in that area of the challenge. That was number one, and he achieved it. And then number two, you have to wait until everybody's distracted. And a win lose situation is a huge, huge distraction. Probably the biggest distraction you can get in a challenge, besides somebody busting their ass or something like that.
or getting on fire like you did, right? You caught on fire.
Yeah, well,
and if you want to know more about that, check out the interview between me and Billy.
Yeah.
But I'm going to actually throw this to Elise because I know you want to comment. Right now, though, real quick, Kelly Wentworth found the idol, Jeremy found the idol in the challenge, and now Troy Zan has found the idol in the challenge. The whole purpose of putting the idol in the challenge is that it's supposed to be really hard. However, we are 3 for 3 and people actually successfully getting it. So they scrapped this idea, or does it still create enough drama?
I think it does create a lot of drama. I do like having it hidden in challenges. I think the trick is you don't want to make it so, okay, only the puzzle people can get it, because especially if you're like a strong guy, you have to be like, no, sorry, guys, I really need to do the puzzle this time. Or like if you're Sandra, and you're like, nope, I think I got the weightlifting thing down today. Like, it's a balance. But that's what the question I had for all of you guys is, like, we've saw Troyzan find the clue on like a random bottle on the beach. Do you think they have to replace that like every single challenge, that episode, that it goes unclaimed? Because every single challenge, it could have a different place that it's hidden. Is that why it's like so easy, just like randomly lying around, as opposed to like in some tricky tree root or buried or something? I don't know. What are your thoughts on that? That's my question watching it.
I think you got it. I think.
No,
go ahead, Billy.
Yeah, hit the nail on the head, I think, Elise, that they made it easy, not just for the players to find it, but for the clue to be replaced.
And I just want to point out how cool it was, because last season we had the idol thing that was the inside, like, the coconut. And this time it's in the message in the bottle, which goes with the whole shipwreck thing. So I'm going to give production some props on the theme. However, artists, I just wanted to make a quick comment. The pirate music, I feel like, is getting a little out of hand. I know it's just a nitpicky thing, but, like, it's like they're walking on the beach, and suddenly it's the same orchestra sound from Pirates of the Caribbean, and I'm like, I don't need this for Zeke talking. I don't get the Johnny Depp vibe. That's just like burning through my head. Go ahead, Billy.
The next reward, they should win Captain Jack Sparrow.
You get well, they had that thing where Rupert was a prize and won like the Israeli version. So in this one, you get Johnny Depp coming, and he's gonna help you build your camp stuff. So something I wanted to highlight, and I guess I'm gonna jump to tie to this, is that for some reason I put down that Zeke was narrating a little bit for the Green Tribe, and Zeke, we saw her be really close, with Suri. And your analysis of the edgic of this past episode, you point out how Zeke's in a really good position. Is he still riding the middle ground? And how long do you think this can actually keep up? Because he could be a good underdog to win.
I think he's in a great position because he is his last tribe. He is now on a tribe with mostly people from his last tribe, with Troyzan as an obvious out. And he hasn't pissed Troyzan off by being transparently fake about the situation at hand, unlike Andrea. So to that end, he's got three, because they may have made up for now, but that's always going to be a thing. And both in the back of their heads. You've got what's going on with Troyzan. I think Zeke's probably in the best position overall on that tribe, because his back isn't against the wall and he's good with everybody. Also Sarah, I guess, but we didn't get anything from her this episode.
Well, and that's actually what I was going to throw to Artist. And, you know, Artist, we've talked very kind of bluntly about your edit. We're now at a point where this episode, Aubrey, Michaela, and Sarah didn't actually get that much screen time. And at what point do you think, when you don't get screen time or confessionals, do you think we should write someone off as a player? Keeping in mind, though, Sandra, I believe, went 4 episodes in Heroes versus Villains without a confessional. What do you take on?
I think the thing is, like, Michaela, she is purposely not saying anything because of how volatile she gets. And she doesn't want to come across the same way she did in her season, as Miss Bossy, or the one person you don't want to piss off because she's just going to let you have it. I think she's purposely toned down her vocalization of everything. Mm-hmm. She, and if you watch her competing, just like in her season, Had she fell down and Malcolm dragged her like he did this in this season, had she done that, had that happened last season, she would have blew up at somebody. She kept her mouth shut.
So maybe she is evolving. And Billy, what do you think? Do you think it's too early for the edgic nerds to be like, Sarah doesn't have a chance, Michaela doesn't have a chance, Aubrey doesn't have a chance?
Yeah, no, I wouldn't write anybody off right now, but I would say that that it looks like they're being set up for the fall in the next episode, especially since two tribes are going to tribal council next episode. Yeah. So I get the impression that there was a setup between Andrea and maybe Sandra for the next episode. That was what I felt like I was getting, like a bucket of water of getting thrown into my face as I'm watching the episode. I'm like, Andrea, dead woman walking.
Yeah, I'm really curious. I'm curious as to how they're going to do that. Are they going to bring both tribes in at tribal and sit down all together? Because that would actually be fireworks.
That would be a good game-changing moment. Now, I think what they're going to do is kind of what they've done when they send both tribes to tribal councils. But what it means is that next week's episode is going to be 5 seconds of camp life and immunity challenge.
A long tribal council.
Yeah, next episode's going to be chaotic. But before I get to next episode, I did want to just kind of talk a little bit more about this one. So, Alicia, it has been pointed out before. Yeah. Bunch of people from Survivor Second Chances Cambodia had a bunch of people from Survivor Cagayan in it. The final three had Tasha and Spencer. Two out of the four Cagayan four. Then you go back to All-Stars, Australian Outback. There were four representatives of it. Amber wins that season. It does seem like, obviously, the more people from your season and an All-Star season, the better everyone does from that season. So do you think it was extremely important that they started targeting the Korong four? And that had a lot to do with Caleb getting the boot tonight? Because, you know, Caleb's there with Debbie, with Ty. There's another one in there. I forget who. Go ahead.
Yeah, of course they do. I think, you know, Survivor, you're put in very uncomfortable situations and you really can't rely on anyone. And so when you have people that you form these bonds with, that even if they're not strong, you did share the same experience on the same season, you know, the same people. And that goes a long way to making people feel comfortable. That's why when people are meeting other people in the real world, they're like, oh, do you know this person? Do you know that person? They play the name game, because it's not so much, you know, do we feel comfortable, but like enough meaningless shit in common that like we can become comfortable.
And I think that's actually a really good psychological point. And Billy pointed out that Parvati won, and she had Ozzy and Pinder at the start. And Billy, something that I wanted you to talk about, I'm going to talk to Ozzy about too, is when you play on a season of Survivor with someone, you're not just out there for the island time. You're going to be there for a little bit preseason. You're going to be there for all the press shit in the end. Like, it's not just a 39-day shared experience. It's a whole bunch of other stuff too. And I mean, Billy, they start you off on a tribe when you play Second Chances with JP. Conversation with him?
You know what? I think for me and JP, it would be a similar situation as Sierra and Haley, where there's no relationship. Yeah, it's like Christina Coria. Well, mm-hmm. We see each other like five or six times a year, which is a lot for former survivors. So yeah, it's like you really don't even have to call each other. You just have to see each other standing on same season on the mat. Yeah, in the case of like poverty starting with the same season and all that, when you stop the same season, enough numbers, enough
chance. Billy, you are extremely glitchy right now. I don't know if you want to leave the call or come back, but I will talk to you if we get a chance. Yeah, it's no problem. But Artis, and I want to try something real quick, all right? Be honest with me, okay?
Of course.
Do you have your phone with you? Like, do you have your cell phone?
Right. All right.
How many contacts on that phone right now from Survivor Philippines could you reach? Out of the 18 people you played with?
Malcolm. RC, Denise, Carter, no Lisa, no, well, of course, no Mike.
no one has
Pete. I would say about seven or Angie. I could reach Angie.
Yeah.
You know, now everybody's in my phone because we actually traded information
exactly
on the plane on the way back. Now, the people that I mentioned are people that I have reached out to say happy birthday to, touch it, see how they're doing. Abby. So I've got, I would say there are at least eight people that I have been in contact with on more than one occasion.
And that's the point I was trying to make is that, you know, playing, you know, even if you, because you and everyone have tried with Angie, but yet you right. still talk to her. She's still part of your sphere. So these groups, these Kaurong 4, the Kagyan 4, Parvatish, Ozzy and Pinner at the beginning, of my, they're so dangerous to keep together. And I actually think the preseason of this one, or the preseason when people were saying we got to get rid of the Kaurong 4, I actually thought they hit the nail on the head because during Second Chances, I was like, you got to get rid of who first? You got to get rid of Spence. You got to get rid of these Kagyan people early on. At least I know you want to comment on that.
Yeah, I just wanted to point out, we haven't really touched too much on Brad's involvement in this move. And as we were saying that it's so important to have these bonds before the game, do you think Brad, because Brad is interesting because his first season was on a half returnee season. So he's already knows what, and his wife is also a former Survivor player. So he knows how close the Survivor community is. And then his one connection on the other tribe that we know of was just voted out. Mm-hmm. So for him, I think it makes it a doubly good move to get rid of Kaurong because he doesn't have the advantage of these pregame relationships and he knows what a big deal they are from his season and from Monica.
Well, and I think that's Monica a fantastic did. Point because, I mean, Billy, we are going to try you real quick. Maybe you'll be better. The internet just messed up sometimes. I blame you, so snowstorm. But Brad Culpepper, his first time around, was edited as kind of a doofus. I personally loved him as a character. A lot of people gave me some flack for that. But this time, he really seems to have those strategic chops. At least said, because he's learned more about the Survivor communities and such.
Yeah, he was interesting the first time. He was entertaining. I agree. And then strategic. He tried to be strategic. It just wasn't in the cards for him. It doesn't mean that he didn't have it in him. And also the point that the glitch got me last time, the more from one season you get, the more the odds that one will win. It's like throwing more balls in the lottery for when a ball comes up. It might be, you know.
Well, and Artis, do you think this could be the beginning of a Kaurong purge? Do you think maybe Aubrey, who has been kind of under the radar, people might just turn to her and go, oh, shit, there's a lot of you guys here. You might as well take another one out. Or do you think Caleb getting cut was the best thing for Aubrey's gameplay or Debbie's gameplay or Ty's game? Because now they're going to go, okay, the Kaurongs aren't a threat anymore. Well, maybe not Ty's game because he got manipulated, but with Debbie and Aubrey, they can't make that connection.
I don't know. With Caleb being cut like that, I think that when they come back and they see that Caleb's gone, I don't think they're going to look at it as a Kagyan thing. I think some people will put it together that Brad was actually scared of Caleb and talked everybody into getting rid of Caleb more than cutting the Kagyan numbers down. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't think that's going to come into play at all. They're going to look at that and say it made no sense to get rid of Caleb. Who on that tribe was so scared of him that they would rather risk going back to tribal council than keep him on the team and run and have a chance at winning the next immunity challenge?
And I think it's a very good point. Go ahead, Billy.
100% of the time, I agree with artists and a lot of what he says. But this time, I'm not sure everybody will put it together because Culpepper had a reputation for putting together the beefcake, you know, kind of falls into that archetype. He's a beefcake. So I think that might slip past some people. I think the people might see it as something else, especially if they give a BS excuse when they stand on the mat.
And I have to do, and famously, we did have Brad Five Guys Burger and Fries Alliance in a contest with that when that happened. But what I kind of wanted to emphasize on was the fact that throughout this whole time, both Caleb's survivor journeys, he's been given a really, really good edit. And people argue that in Quran, his sympathetic edit came from the fact that he, you know, almost died and was medically evac'd. Then this time around, he was given, you know, not the strappers of sword edits, but still a pretty good guy. But do any of y'all watch Big Brother? Because in Big Brother, apparently the story is completely different. And Elise, I do want to talk about this. Elise, what do you think is the real Caleb? Or do you think it's somewhere in between? Or do you think maybe he grew up? Because, I mean, he did get married. And then, Ty, I will jump to you in a couple seconds about that. But Elise, what did you make of Caleb's hero edit in this and then being a not flattering edit in Big Brother? What do you think?
Well, I think he probably learned a lot from his Big Brother experience and just like being in front of the, because Big Brother, you're in front of the cameras 24/7. And because of the live feeds, people see every single moment on that. Survivor, you can be a douchebag and maybe it won't make the edit. Maybe it will. It probably will. But, you know,
well, or you could be like artist and be amazing and it somehow doesn't make the edit, which is shenanigans.
But Big Brother, his big thing, one, he was just kind of strung along. I don't think he was very strategic. And second, he had kind of like this weird, creepy crush on this one girl who clearly was not having any of it. So maybe being married, like having some sort of bromance with Ty is a lot better look than this one-sided romance.
Big Brother. And that's why I pretend to have a crush on Ty, because it balances out all my creepy attributes. Right, Ty?
Sure.
I believe you wanted to comment real quick.
I did. I don't think he got a hero edit this time around. Last time he was kind of part of Tony's arc because he was Tony's friend, and then Tony got voted out. This time he was Ty's friend, and Ty wanted to protect him. And he also said something kind of douchey to Haley about how he was smarter than her. Mm-hmm. And I thought was kind of dismissive of her tribal council. So this whole idea that, like, he's a douche on Big Brother kind of came out a little bit at the exact wrong time where they were deciding ostensibly who to get rid of. So I don't agree that he got a hero edit this time.
Well, you know, I'm very rarely wrong. Like, I'm very rarely wrong. I did pick Venus. I like how artists started laughing the moment I said I'm not wrong that much. And he's only been on this show for like one season. Yes, I picked Venus as a winner pick. I picked Jennifer as a winner pick. But still, I will say I thought for sure Haley was going tonight. I was actually starting to type up the, you know, oh, Haley's gone, all these people are going to be upset. But was I the only one to see that, Billy? Or was, come on, the edit was pointing towards Haley. And why do you think they like to pull these trickeries on these kind of smaller votes of who's going to go?
Obviously, you a lot of these votes are made to look a lot closer than they are, just mm-hmm. to make for drama and for entertainment. My vote, the vote where I was eliminated, it looked like, hey, maybe I might swing Christina and Cecilia, and they're strategizing in Spanish. Meanwhile, my fate was decided before my feet ever touched land at the beginning of the day one. So, you know, it's just part of the entertainment factor of it, because it is a TV show. Its main purpose is to be entertainment first and then competition second. But I didn't mind that we got a little swerve there. That was actually entertaining. You know, I liked it. I was like, good. You know, it sucked. From Caleb's point of view, I'm sure he disagrees with me, was good, but I thought it was good.
Well, I'm going to throw something else out here. I'm going to throw another bomb, and Artis, I want you to answer it. I'm probably going to jump some other people too. My bomb is this. Oh, okay. Haley, Sandra are going to go next week. And if it's not those two, oh, crap. Who was the other person that was getting the horrible edit? This is embarrassing.
I think it was Andrea. Andrea.
One of those three are going next. All right, two of those three are going next week, and nothing's going to change. I mean, it's all been set up because we have so little time to actually.
I agree.
I don't know.
All right, we got Billy Graham
and Andrea.
In the preview for next episode, we saw JT trying to target Sandra. So are they really going to like talk about that in this, like, in next week's promo, and it actually happened, and then like no one's surprised, and they're like, "Yep,
we might." But I wanted to throw that bomb at Artis though, because he's still digesting it. And here's why I think those three are completely done, and I could be wrong. It's because next week there's going to be so little time to actually show the camp life and the scrambling. They might not have enough time to, like, you know, build up someone random. Like, Sarah, they're not going to build her up in the 4 minutes that it takes to then get her booted. That's my reason why I'm thinking that. Then I'm going to jump to Ty, because Ty wants to get on this. more than he wants to get in on cheeseburgers.
I love Sandra, but if they need to get rid of her quick, fast, and in a hurry. The longer she stays in the game, the more I'm going to have – they're going to have to write her name on that check, and she's just going to make everybody else that played look like an ass. Because there is no way in the hell you're supposed to let somebody who's already won the game twice walk in there and win it again.
Well, and the fact that she's already survived two tribal councils is blowing my mind.
Well, it's easy to survive tribal council if you – well, she's only went the one. It's easy to survive tribal if you never go.
Oh, she went to two in the first episode. Because remember, Sierra and Tony were on a tribe.
This is the third. Oh, this is the third. Oh, okay. I lost track. Okay, yeah. Oh, that's right. Because it was a two season. Right. Yeah. So, yeah, I'm like this. I mean, I told her I would look at her. I love her dearly, but she's got to go. If I end up going home because I'm shooting hard at getting her out of here, I'd be okay with that, because there is no way in
someone
hell
has I'm going to take sit her there.
Right, and I'm not going to sit there at trial. I'm not going to sit there at the final three and say, oh, they'll never give her $1 million again. Fuck, that's how she got the second million.
oh, and I got to say, her saying that argument to people and people kind of buying it blew my mind. I'm like, if she makes it to the end, you have to give it to her out of fucking principle, in my opinion.
There is no way you're supposed to let her make it to the end. She cannot be that goddamn good.
And if she does, you give it to her. So, Ty, you're itching at this. Why?
You think that Haley had a terrible episode? That is absolutely positively ridiculous. She had a great tribal council where she basically turned everything Caleb said against him and basically helped send him back. I mean, it was Culpepper's move, but she
did. Right. She saved herself.
Two tribes are going to tribal council. I think the red tribe is perfectly safe. I think she's going to make it to the next swap because she had a good episode. And even if they were to lose again, you have Debbie, whose mouth gets her in trouble. Have Ty, whose mouth gets him into trouble. She can make some waves. She could likely survive. I have to be biased because I got stuck with her as my winner pick. But that being said, I do partially agree with the rest of it. There's no way that JT's tribe doesn't go to tribal council, and I'm pretty sure Andrea's going to get idled. You're right that the boots are set. There's no way the red tribe goes.
Okay. I like that because hopefully the red tribe will go and it'll change it all up. So did anyone – I think we've actually done a pretty good job analyzing this episode. Does anyone have any kind of final thoughts, last-minute comments? I mean, proud of Sandra for surviving two tribal councils, but her time should be up. Alicia.
Yeah.
Billy, go first, and then I'll come.
Aw, you're so sweet. I was just going to say, even though we're all expect Sandra to go, and let's say she does, her accomplishments, because as Artis kept saying over and over again, this is the woman that should have went first this season, because that was common sense, and yet she dodged bullets like Keanu Reeves in the movie The Matrix.
I agree.
she proved herself that, you know, her reputation is safe as one of the greatest.
I don't think anyone would try to take that away from her. Ty, you had your hand up. Did you want to jump somewhere?
Just feeding to the point where we might be premature, because I said their tribe is going to tribal council. It's very possible that JT still gets booted. I think that's possible. Maybe. It could be
our very idea. Fair. Okay. So Alicia, we haven't spoken much today, but I know you want to talk about more than just the goats.
So I want to go back to Ty. I feel bad for him this episode because he was really in a damned if you do, damned if you don't situation.
But he keeps putting himself in it.
Still, think about it. If he's... I know. But like, okay, say he keeps Caleb. Yay for his game. All of the rest of the tribe is like, well, we know who his loyalty is to. It's to Caleb. It's not to us. So if they ever go... He is going to be in some hot water. And yet, because he ended up voting out Caleb to try and show them that he was going to be loyal to them, they can turn it around and be like, he just voted out his closest friend. He'll vote out us, like, next. So let's get him out. Like, it's just a shitty situation all around. Like, there's no way he comes out of that winning.
All right, so Ty, I think you wanted to have a quick little response to that, and I wanted to go to
Artis. And something of a Ty expert being a Ty. As somebody who also, of course, knows about one's mouth getting him into trouble. Ty already screwed himself because Ty told Brad he was willing to get rid of Debbie before Caleb. Like, right. No amount of, like, the moment he did that, he was done. He was absolutely done. The idea of the Khaurang people sticking together was done because he already threw Debbie's name under the bus. Also, Debbie and him didn't have a great relationship in their season. But Ty always screws himself. He's too emotional, and he talks too damn much.
And that's true. All right, Billy and Elise want to comment on that, so I'm going to jump to Billy real quick.
I was just agreeing with everything that Ty was saying right there. Ty just blabs and blabs and blabs, and he basically, you know, I think he mistaken this game like it's blind man's bluff where you put your card on your forehead and everybody knows your card except for you. I think that's what Ty thinks of how this game is played.
I love that analogy.
You're not in a good way.
I mean, I don't disagree with you. Artis, did you have any, Elise?
Oh, yeah, no, I just wanted to say, like, let's say Ty didn't massively screw up like we all said he did. He had a perfectly good excuse to keep Caleb around because Caleb is so good in the challenges. Like, he literally died. Like, his one thing that makes him a game changer is that he literally died to win his tribe. Like, I don't know, some paltry like a reward. Bean or something. Yeah. So, like, that's a huge reason to keep Caleb around. So if he was just like, yeah, we haven't talked that much, or eh, yeah, no, he'd be good to keep around, instead of like, I'd rather keep him over Debbie, I need to do this, and then getting all up in his head and talking too much, it could have been an easy Haley boot. I think Haley did a good job. I don't think she's out of hot water yet, but
and that's the thing is, right there. Was this Ty being wishy-washy, or does Brad have that much control? I think it lies somewhere in between. But I am so happy Brad finally got some goodness going, because I knew he had it in him, just like with Troyzan. You, all the people on the internet, Artis, I don't know if you know those people on the internet, they hate Troyzan, they hate Brad. I liked him as characters, and I liked them during their seasons, and I always catch flack for that. So watching them not be completely horrible is fantastic. Artis, did you have any final thoughts to kind of round out this episode, round out this discussion? What you're looking forward towards next? Looking forward to next week?
Actually, I like the fact that even though I don't consider a lot of these people game changers, I do like the fact that certain people are actually willing to go after other people instead of just sitting back and just, you know, letting it and just skating by. Just like, although Tony's gone, I love the fact that he blatantly said that, look, we got to get rid of Sandra. Everybody was thinking it, but Tony was the only one to say it. Everybody's thinking it on the game right now, but not a whole lot of people are saying it, you know? So, but at some point, and that's going to be the demise of them during this season, is to sit back, not only with Sandra, but Ozzy as well, you know, to sit back and think, we, you know, to yourself, oh, I got to get rid of this person. I'm not going to be the one that started. I'm just going to jump on the bandwagon when it does start. No, these people are there for a reason. These people got far for it. They instill fear when they're in the game. Mm-hmm. And that is the one thing that'll kill you playing this game, is to be scared.
Elise, real quick to finish.
Oh yeah, I just wanted to say, it's kind of like the goats. Everyone's thinking, no, we don't want to eat it, but they're going after it anyway.
And I think that was a great analogy for the season. I like that. And real quick, before Haley was given a confessional, we did see a snake, and Haley said she was the snake in the grass. So maybe that's some visual imagery to help out her case. I still think she's not going to win. But I am going to wrap things up. So I want to thank everyone so much for joining us and watching us. I want to thank Elise. I want to thank Ty. I want to thank my wonderful Latina Flavor co-host, Alicia. Of course, Billy Garcia. And, of course, the amazing Artis. Thank you guys so much. And I will see all of you guys next week. Well, not all of you, but most of you next week. And it's going to be 2 tribal counts. It's going to be amazing. And be sure to enter that fan winner contest so you can win some underwear.
And watch the after show. Don't forget.
Oh, and don't forget the after show. We do have a new after show. Elise, real quick. What's the after show? Why do we watch it?
So the after show, basically what we do is we break down the gameplay and what went wrong for the players as they're voted out. This week, we're going to be talking all with Billy Garcia about Caleb. So check for that on Saturday. And yeah.
And I was in the last one, and I'm really good looking, so check that out. Goodbye.